gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see the angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice. Heard about this baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just want to sing this song to you. It goes like this: a fourth, a fifth, a minor fall, and a major lift. With every breath I'm singing hallelujah. Couple came to Bethlehem expecting child. They searched the inn to find a place, for you were coming soon. There was no place for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born. Oh, hallelujah. The shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel and Savior, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I know you came to rescue me. This baby boy would grow to be a man one day and die for me and you. My sin would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew was hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
My name is Lee Ridens, and I'm pastor of Greater Hope Baptist Church here in Dallas. And on behalf of the family, I'd like to welcome you and just say thank you for your support. I'm sure it means a lot to the family, and obviously the family recognizes that you don't have to be here on a Sunday. And I know it does their heart good to see many fill this place up for their love and admiration for Jamie Thackston. Wasn't hard to love Jamie. For those of you that knew him as a friend, it just was an easy thing to do. Jamie walked into our church many, many years ago, and jumped right in and helped. And today it's a testimony to what Jamie's life meant to many. And I know the family would like to say thank you from the bottom of their hearts. Jamie Thackston, James Michael Thackston, 45 years old, Dallas, Georgia, passed away on February 15th in 2024 at his home peacefully. He was born on July 30th, 1978, in Dallas, Georgia, to Mr. James Larry Thackston and Miss Barbara Cole Thackston. He's a loving husband to Mrs. Jennifer Waters Thackston and a loving father and grandfather. He worked as an electrician for Georgia Power. Mr. Thackston is preceded in death by his mother, Barbara Thackston, Brother Jerry Brown, and Brother Scott Brown. He's survived by his wife, Jennifer, his children, Mercy Grace Thackston, Anastasia, James Dylan Thackston, Abigail Thackston, grandchildren, Ruby Siegel, stepchildren, Noel Siegel, and Kennedy, father Larry Thackston, sister Barbie Thackston, stepbrother Jared Ferguson, stepbrother Brandon Pruitt, stepsister Deanne Kerrigan, and many nieces and nephews. Now, we come to celebrate and remember the life of Jamie Thackston. Definitely one cut short. 45 years old. But I do believe it was a life that was lived and enjoyed for what it's worth. You know, I doesn't matter the circumstances, but there's really nothing that can prepare you for death. There's nothing that can alleviate the shock. And we all knew that. I mean, I can't tell you how many times Jamie called me and told me that, hey, it's getting closer, and it's getting closer, and it's getting closer, and they gave me this long, and they gave me this long, and you can work, and you can prepare as much as you want to prepare until it happens. It's never easy to lose a loved one. It actually doesn't matter what stage of life they were in. No matter the good times, no matter the bad times, no matter the past. Really, no matter where the relationship was, it's always hard to lose a loved one. Even to the man that's placed his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and truly knows he's been born again of above, it's still not easy. I say it in our church quite frequently. We don't have to sorrow as people that have no hope. I don't have to sorrow as a person that doesn't have the promise of eternal life. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 tells us that if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which are asleep in Jesus will God bring with Him. I remember Jamie coming to the church years ago, and he walked in the door of that church, I don't know, 7, 8 years ago now, maybe 9. And you could tell he was in a crazy spot. Jamie got saved about 3 months after he came there. And it wasn't very long, a few months after that, Jamie wanted to get baptized. And so we baptized Jamie there in the church. And I watched God change his life. I watched God do things in his life. And it wasn't just overnight, but it was a steady progression. I also watched him some years later come to me and big, long talk. And he ain't ashamed of this. He'd tell you straight up. Came to my office, knocked on my door one day and said, hey, we got to talk. And we spent the next hour or so and Jamie just going through things in his life and talking about things that happened to him and things that went on in his life and how he wanted to make some things right. And there, in that moment, made those things right. And look, I'm not his jury nor his judge. But I am grateful that I got to be a part of those moments. I'm grateful that I can stand here and tell you that I was a part of those. I was there, and it looked like God really working in his life. You see, I found that a lot of times, the death of a person that you love, it usually brings you to a place to where you start thinking deeper than you ever thought before. You usually start reevaluating things that you never would have evaluated in the first place. You start evaluating your relationships with those that are close to you. You start thinking about those that were at one time close to you, but now they're not. And you start thinking about how significant time really is. And James, the book of James says, life's as a vapor. It appeareth for a little while, and then it vanisheth away. And then you start thinking, time really is significant. You start thinking about what the purpose of your life is. And you start thinking about maybe the relationship that you have with your Creator or the one that you don't have. Man, I'm not going to take much of your time, but I would like to give you just something that God gave me many years ago that's helped me tremendously in times like this, and I believe it's helped many others. John chapter number 13. Jesus is talking to his disciples. And he said, "You seek me, and as I said unto the Jews, whether I go, ye cannot come." And then Peter goes into this big spiel about, Lord, wherever you're going, I'm going with you. And he says, Lord, I'm going to lay down my life for your sake. And we all know, may not know, but there's a lot of us know, he didn't actually follow through with that. But in John chapter 14, so this is the end of John chapter number 13. John chapter number 14, it's a very, very familiar passage. It's a familiar passage in funerals a lot of times. But this helped me on another level. He tells them, he says, hey, whither I go, you cannot come. So these 12 disciples that's laid their life down to follow Jesus, and they're going everywhere with Jesus, he's now telling them, hey, you can't go where I'm going. And then in verse number 14, out of the blue, he says, let not your heart be troubled. So if you've been to many funerals, maybe some church services here and there, you've probably heard, man, don't let your heart be troubled. There's a lot of verses that are on, you know, little plaques and stuff. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. And so here, Jesus is addressing the trouble that's plaguing the disciples at the moment. He's addressing what is bothering them. Like, whatever the distress in their heart is at the moment that can't be seen, Jesus addresses it. And so I want you to understand that what Jesus knows is sometimes people aren't seen in their distress. They hide it so well. They're so troubled and they're so bothered. And they hide it. Man, look, you're going to leave here and you're going to think, well, I made it through another funeral sermon. And look, that's fine. I was lost for 24 years before God ever convinced me that this thing was real. Man, I did everything I could to get away from Jesus for 24 years until finally he just had all I could stand. We do real good at hiding stuff. The disciples, you can't tell it from reading the Bible, but they're troubled. What are they so troubled about? Well, they're troubled that Jesus just said that you can't go where I'm going. And so he says, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. And then Thomas says, Lord, we know not whither thou goest or how we can know the way. So he said, man, we don't know where you're going, and we don't even know the way that you're going. And then Jesus says this statement, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh to the Father but by me. And so Jesus makes a big, bold statement. Listen, I know y'all are worried. I know you're troubled. I know your heart is got some trouble. I know it's in distress. Again, we can't see it just from reading the Bible. But Jesus looks on their heart and he sees that inside, don't you listen, there is no peace in their heart. And there's no peace because they don't know how to get where Jesus is going. I found out that the problem with me when I was 24 years old is I didn't know how to get where Jesus was going, where he had gone to. You're in here and you're like, man, I thought we was going to get to talk about James. Listen, his wife said, just do what he would have wanted you to do. I'm doing exactly what he would have wanted me to do. I didn't come here to honor you. I came here to honor the Lord first, and I came here to do what Jamie Thackston came in our church and heard many times. You see, I remember Jamie came to faith in Christ. It was such a hard deal because Jamie had so many things that he felt like he wasn't worthy of Jesus' sacrifice, that he felt like he wasn't worthy of Jesus' saving. And so it took me a long time to finally explain to him, hey, you know what? It ain't about how much sin you got. It ain't about all the things that you've done. It ain't about your past. It ain't about all the stuff that you feel like you got to answer for. It ain't about any of that. I said, Jamie, you were just born into this. And you know, that's a real good way to understand that you and me were born into this thing. You didn't ask for it. You're just born into it. You were born, Romans 5 and verse 12 says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And what that means is that every single person in this room was born into it. There's no escaping it. If you've been born after Adam, you were born into it. You see, there's this ideology that permeates a lot of our thinking that I'm going to do good enough. And there ain't no doing good enough. Why? Because we're all born into it. Because we're all born into it. This afternoon, man, we look at the smiling pictures of Jamie, and I don't know how many of you. It didn't take much to get a smile out of Jamie. It could be so bad. You could be talking. I mean, we'd be crying 1 minute, and the next minute he'd be smiling just as big as he could smile. Now, I sure am glad that I can smile today knowing that there is actually an eternal life and there is actually a way, and His name's Jesus Christ. And I watched a man place his faith and trust in Jesus Christ as his only Savior. Now, we're all wanting to get to the same place. But it's going to take you realizing, hey, you know what? I'm a sinner. It's going to take you realizing that, man, the only way to get there, for all have sinned. Like all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It's going to take all of us coming to a place to where we realize, you say, I don't know that Jesus really loves me. I don't know that Jesus really loves me. And in Romans chapter 5, he says this, that God commended His love toward us, that in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So while we were sinners, if you want to say it like this, Jesus Christ would have died for you if you're the only sinner on earth. He took some punishment. He took some pain, and all of it was ours. Every single bit of it was ours. And today, all right, here we are, and I mean, there's probably different opinions. Some's going to say he's a really great man. Some's going to say he's a pretty good man. Nobody knows anybody till they live with him. Amen. We oftentimes say it. Nobody knows me like my wife knows me. But here's what I will say. It don't matter who knows anybody. And what they know about anybody, and what they know about the past, and what they feel like they could have done better, and the rights they could have wronged, and all of that we're talking about right now. What is in your heart as far as peace goes? Jesus Christ made a way for me. Jesus Christ made a way for you. Jesus Christ made a way for Jamie. Jamie was one of the last ones we baptized in our old baptistry there at the church. He helped me work on stuff. He helped me wire stuff up. He helped me, a lot of stuff he helped around the church with. I didn't touch the wiring unless I was trying to burn something down. If I wanted to have an insurance claim, I guess I could have done the wiring. I asked Jamie one day, I said, hey, you think you can wire, redo the... It's about a 1970 model block building. And I was like, you think you could rewire this thing? He's like, yeah, I can rewire this thing. He'd been there but just a few weeks, and I gave him a key to get in, and he just came whenever he wanted to come and went and done his thing and worked through it and got it to where, and it, you know, got done. It was beautiful. Looked great. Wiring was right. I walked by that panel box just a few days ago, and it's in the basement there going down to the nursery. And I looked at that old panel box, and I thought, man, there is, and it's probably trivial to you guys, but there's some stuff that's been left behind. There's some stuff that's been left behind to his brothers and sisters in that church that are grateful and thankful for him. They're Brother Daniel singing, and great friends. And there's a lot to be thankful for. But the most important thing that I want you to remember about today, there's probably some of you in this room that he tried to talk about the Lord to. Maybe you blew him off. Maybe you didn't want to hear it. Maybe you thought he was crazy. Maybe you thought that, man, all that's a hoax. All that giving your life to Jesus business is crazy. Let me help you. It is crazy at times. But I sure am glad I did it. And I'll say this, I think Jamie is too. Well, how do you do that? Well, you got to call on him. You say, I don't really know how to make my way through that whole thing. I'll tell you what I'd do. After this whole thing's over with, you say, I don't know how to do that. I'll do what me and Jamie did one Sunday after church. He said, hey, can I talk to you? Yeah. And lo and behold, here we are today, some 8-9 years later, because of that one conversation. He said, hey, can I talk to you after church? Listen, I ain't nothing special. I just got a really, really good God. And he would save your soul in a second. And listen, and it would be such a profitable thing for Jamie Thackston to leave out of this service today. For his memorial service to go down with maybe one of his friends, maybe one of his old work buddies, maybe one of his family members to place their faith in Jesus Christ, because there's absolutely no peace. It's a desert haunting your life. And God wants to give you eternal life. I want to pray for you. But Daniel, he's going to get ready there. He's going to come sing one more. But I'd like to, if I could, just take a minute. And I'd just like to pray for you. Lord, we realize the frailty of life in situations like this. Or realize that our friends that go home too early, they bring a special kind of thought process to what it's going to look like if we go home early. Or when we go home at all. God, there ain't no doubt that there's many people in this room. Man, they want to trust you, Lord. They want eternal life. They want peace. And they know you're the only way. They just can't bring themselves to make the jump. God, I'm asking you to give them a space. A space that, God, that you'd work in their life. And God, that you could see them come to you in this moment and in this space. God, the world's loud, and I'm really grateful that you can bring peace to us. Lord, I want to say thank you for Jamie. Thank you, Lord, for his life. Lord, thank you for letting us be friends and Thank you for letting me see all the things that I got to see in his life. And his, thank you for his friends that are here today that are celebrating and that know Jesus Christ and know his testimony. And they're thankful for that because they know where he is and they know where they're going. Lord, we love you. And it is truly an honor to be able to be here and just say a few words. Lord, for somebody in this room that's deeply burdened about where they stand with the Lord, I pray, God, Lord, I'd love to show them how to come to faith in Christ. Maybe today, Lord, after this whole thing's over with, it'd be somebody so bold to do that. God, give the one peace that needs it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Seen my last tomorrow, I am holding my last breath. Goodbye, sweet world of sorrow, my new life begins with death. I am standing on the mountain. I can hear the angel's songs. I am reaching over Jordan. Take my hand. Lord, lead me home. All my burdens are behind me. I have prayed my final prayer. Don't you cry over my that ain't me lying there. I am standing on the mountain. I can hear the angel song. I am reaching over Jordan. Take my hand, lead me home. Take my hand, Lord, lead me home.